about it is the people, the closer they get to me, they can go through lots of waves of fear because I followed a pathway that said, you know, to learn this course, meaning to learn forgiveness, requires willingness to question every value that you hold, every belief. And I've always been very, very open-minded. During university and afterwards, I was the kind of student, like I'm sure yourself and many people here, this is like an interfaith community. Yes, yes. And I had a book stand with so many books on that I was reading all kinds of different teachings from around the world, and for centuries they go back. So I was quite well read, and I was very well, and then even friends of mine who would get involved in Way of Mastery would send me John Mark's stuff back then, or now it's called JM and this and this, and I had the Holy Spirit going through, and Jesus giving me commentary on these works as well, as I could hear the Holy Spirit like Helen Schuckman, and Jesus just as clear as we're speaking now. So as I was sharing recently, I would have people sending me so many things, and I would get commentary. I really had gone from having a nightstand full of books to A Course in Miracles, because it was saying, this course has everything that you need. Come with me and have an experience, and then from that point, we'll extend the wisdom and love once your mind is clear. We need to clear the channel. And so I said, okay, I'm yours. I'll call it Jesus, Jeshua. It doesn't matter, the names don't matter to me. I just want consistent peace of mind. So then I did go very deeply into it, and then suddenly I became so happy that I had people following me and coming to me as saying, you are my teacher, you are my teacher. Some of them were so open and willing that they would even say things like, please point out anything that you see. Because I'm not big on pointing things out with people or correcting anybody, but unless it's an invitation. So then I started having people following me saying, please point this out. If you see anything at all, please point this out, point this out. I said, okay. And they would bring in a lot of books. They'd bring in, you know, Brent Haskell, Robert Perry, John Mark Hammer's work, JM, and not only that, but beautiful. Joel Goldsmith, Infinite Way, Mary Baker Eddy. They would bring in Upanishads. They'd bring in Khalil Gibran. They'd bring in Wayne Dyer. They bring in Ram Dass. You know, people come from, there's a huge array of beautiful spiritual pathways to God. And I appreciate them all because I've read them too. So it's not like I discount something that I haven't benefited from greatly. But when it gets down to the roots of the core beliefs, which is really what awakening's about, you get down deeper and deeper, that's when Jesus said the way is narrow, and it starts to just really, you move through some more fluff, I would say spiritual fluff, and religious, theological fluff, and you start to get down to the simplicity, because I've always known truth is simple. It can be spoken in many languages and many words, but the actual experience is just one. One experience, many branches that lead there. So I have a great respect for interfaith, I have a great respect for all these teachers and authors, and I do find that as I've gone very, very, very deep, the spirit is very uncompromising, as I have been uncompromising in my mind, because I want peace of mind. I want to transfer the training, including the training towards those spiritual beliefs that oftentimes take you so far, and then the floor falls out, and you've got to drop down into an experience that's beneath those beliefs, go all the way to the core. So I also am very eclectic, so I feel just as comfortable with an atheist, or a Buddhist, or a Muslim, or a Sufi, or a Christian. You know, it doesn't really matter. I feel very at home with everyone now, in my state of mind. So I have very friendly, kind talks with everyone. And also, I've found that I've gone deeper that certain things just get exposed. Like one time I was in California And a friend of mine said, there's a Sai Baba house out there, and would you go and give a talk at the Sai Baba house? So I went there, and there was a big picture of Sai Baba, and there was food. It was like an altar, food for him. And I was just joking in the car the other day. I said, if this body ever dies, please don't bring food for me. Give it to the poor. Don't put it on an altar around the body of David or something. Just making jokes, but really, sincerely, I'm here to undo spiritual specialness. I'm here to undo idol worship. I'm here teaching that there are no persons that are enlightened. That's something that came out of Armel's mouth last night and we talked about. So I went there and I gave the talk, and it was letting go of all rituals and all spiritual specialness, and I went through the gamut of things, gave the whole talk, and I think Kirsten was with me at the time, and she was kind of afraid that I was going to get chased out of the Sai Baba house. So she kept watching as I was going deeper and deeper and undoing a lot of these beliefs there. And she was amazed that people got happier and happier and happier. And when I finished the talk, they all came up and hugged me and rejoiced with me. And she said, amazing. I thought you'd be chased out and you were hugged instead. One time I was down in Florida and there was a group from Endeavor Academy down there, an offshoot of A Course in Miracles that some people said was a bit cultish and so forth. And it was like Pentecost. I was speaking and their eyeballs were rolling in their eye sockets, and they were moving stuff around. Their hair was flying all over the place, and they were whooshing and making all these making sounds and everything like this. And the whole talk was undoing a lot of beliefs around spiritual specialness. And again, the same kind of thing happened. And my friend Resta was with me at the time. And she was listening to the talk and she was like, oh, they're gonna be an angry mob here. He is absolutely undoing everything that the whole group believes in. And they were hissing and moving like it was Pentecost while I was speaking. And at the end, she thought, well, I hope we get out of here alive. And they all came up and hugged me. And she was like, amazing. They must not have heard a thing that he was talking about. But that's the beautiful thing of it is that I let the Spirit just pour through from a place of joy and happiness. And if people hang with me, they feel that joy and happiness, even though there can be certain beliefs that are popped along the way. And that's just the way that it seems to go. I know, like with JM, Way of Mastery, they'll talk a lot about the breath and so on and so forth. That's not emphasized at all in A Course in Miracles. And so in different aspects like that, and when people ask me questions about that, I'm happy to address those things in a very, very direct way. But what I told the students years ago was, they said, well, we're going to go at removing the obstacles to love's awareness. That's why you're here. If you want to come and be with me, that's what it's for. I said, you're welcome to bring in any book you want, any video, nothing's off limits. You know, bring anything, I'm happy. But when you raise the question, if you raise the question from Way of Mastery or from the Upanishads or the Bhagavad Gita or whatever, make sure it's your own question. Make sure it's just coming from your heart, and I will be aligned with the Spirit, and I will address your question for the good of everyone here. But don't just be trying to compare and contrast different teachers. I'm not interested in comparing and contrasting teachers. If you want to compare and contrast Joe Goldsmith and Mary Baker Eddy, I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in the truth, and I will address your question. If you have a metaphysical question or a question around belief, I'm happy to address that very directly. But I didn't want the students to get into the habit of comparing and contrasting different teachers and different pathways. So that's just my approach. And you probably heard a particular YouTube where I probably was addressing a few things like that, and that's just what I do. That's my job.
Yeah, I feel I would like to say something about that because in my experience, what really I feel has attracted me to follow David is actually that it was very direct and totally uncompromising. Even though there was definitely fear to follow it, something in my heart resonated so deeply. I didn't even know what when I met David in June 2009. I just knew, and for me it was like, this is it. I have no idea of what it is, but this is it, and that's what I followed. Just this is it. In my experience, as I told you, I just started the course, so I never heard about awakening. I never heard about that. I didn't know what it was. I learned about it once I got married with Eric because he really wanted to be enlightened. So I was like, what is enlightened?
Your first view of awakening was when the alarm clock goes off in the morning. That's a good start. Not a lot of preconceived ideas about enlightenment.
Yeah.
Oh, awakening.
I really didn't have any spiritual beliefs, but they all came after, actually, because after I started to encounter a lot of other teachings, and when Eric would start to talk to me about enlightenment, then I would start to be aware of it, and then I could see in my mind there was a chasing for that. Then it wasn't there before because it was unknown, but once I became aware of it, it's like, oh, I want that. I want, that's what I want, and I want that. So it was really funny because I could see that anytime I would just start to open up in such a deep way and really just go for it. Actually, I would stop reading the course. I would put the course on the side. I would stop reading it. And then I would encounter another teacher and I would start reading their book. And it was really helpful though, because I really felt that anytime I was too much in fear to really go deeper, it's like the spirit would bring me something that would still allow me to question things, but not going at the pace where I felt I wasn't ready to go. And I would just do that for years. It's been like that. I just feel like I had a huge spiritual overview of everything. And I would just allow, again, that to be used exactly as it was given and not judge, oh, you're not reading the course. You're really not a good course student. Oh, you're not reading David's material. You're not listening to David. You're listening to this one, and this one. And starting to judge myself. It's like, no, I really trusted that if I wasn't going in one way, there was something else that was coming for me that would help me to keep undoing whatever I was believing that in the moment was most helpful for me. And in the depth of it, allowing actually all that really helped me to come in touch with this depth of desire in my heart where I knew that only David's words and only where he's teaching from was what I truly wanted. It's like I could see I would just follow some Advaita teacher, Advaita Vedanta, it's also a non-dual teaching. And I would go there because somewhere I was too scared of fully following my calling. And it would just be, yeah, they still talk about the world, and the world is still like, it's still there, there's still manifestation, there's still all that. And somewhere it was less scary than accepting the full truth. But only the full truth will release you. And so I really realized at some point that, okay, I think I'm really called to believe the course fully. I feel like it's time to stop spiritual shopping and to really go for it. And that's what I did. I just really poured my whole heart into it and really just went so deep in my heart that I just really looked at everything and just let go, like really let go, let go, let go, and just really realized the only thing that was resonating with me in a very deep level was being totally uncompromising. And I started to apply that for myself in a very deep way with absolutely everything. And for sure, that's the only thing that I can extend, because I know that's the only thing that truly works. And I just can't imagine start to sugarcoat for anybody just so that they will feel safe, because truly that would make the error real. That would make the error seeming like, yeah, they are real people and some have it and some don't, and you need to be careful and you need to be gentle. I don't know what gentleness is. The spirit knows. I have no idea what's best for anyone. The spirit knows. and allowing the form to be used and the word to be spoken through, that's the best thing you can ever do for anyone, to really, like in the true empathy section, step back and not interfere, and allowing the spirit teach you what is true empathy, and not thinking that we know anything. So I feel that that is really important, to be aware of that, how we use other teaching actually to avoid our calling more than to really go deeper. And yes, at time it will be used, but there's a point where the decision will have to be made, because truly the awareness of truth has been lost by your desire for something else than truth, but it can come back to you in a split second by only desiring that.